A little housekeeping. Notice we're taking attendance. The lectures, we're starting to get more and more people. The fire marshal says you can only have so many. So we don't want people who called up and reserved a seat to wind up standing or being turned away. So if you come a couple minutes early, we are, anyone that reserves a seat, first come, first serve. After everyone's here, if there are more seats, anyone that walks in can come in, because we, that's really the fair way to do it. Secondly, everyone with a cell phone, if you will put it on mute or shut it off, would be, we should all disconnect every once in a while. We have some pens up here. If you need a pen. One of the things we do here at Johnson's, and welcome, I'm glad you all could come, we do offer the night of the lecture, everything in the store is 20% off. And we don't play games saying anything that isn't on, that is on sale, you don't get it. It's 20% across the board. The only thing that isn't is prescriptions, and that's because the state doesn't allow that. What else? You all have on your seat a pad of paper, our sales flyer, and a flyer for the upcoming lectures next month and the month after. And you can sign up upstairs or you can do it online. The debate is tonight. When we scheduled this, they didn't have a debate scheduled. So we're going to call Trump and Clinton and ask them if they would change it. But we figured they're having enough problems between the two of them. Couple of things. We'll have everyone done and out. If you want to stay longer, you can. But you'll be able to get out to get in your car and get aggravated on the ride home. One thing I will caution you with the debates and with a little editorial with the political climate as it is, it's stressful for most of us. That makes us go into fight or flight. It stresses the adrenals. It screws up sleep. It makes blood sugar go up. Brian will be talking about when you're stressed, why you stressy, why you're hungry, because you're not using your blood sugar appropriately. So remember, we're all going to survive the election. It might not be good. It might not be the way we want it. But deep breath, and we'll make it through. I used to have a full head of hair, so that's for me. Okay. Blood sugar issues. Real, real big problem. There's a big problem with the younger generation. There's a lot of obese young kids, and there was a statistic out that the majority of them will be diabetic when they get into their 20s. And the sad part about that is that most of that is self-inflicted. A lot of it, or some of it, can be genetic. But most of us that are putting on the belly fat, that are told we're pre-diabetic, don't worry about it, because when it gets bad enough, we have pills. And when the pills don't work and your pancreas dies, we can always give you insulin. The vast majority of people that have blood sugar regulation and insulin sensitivity, you can change that and not become a diabetic. But it takes work. And so it takes lifestyle changes, diet changes. We're going to talk about some of the supplements. Some people need just a little something. It's like seasoning a soup. You just need a little help. Some people need a lot of help. There's programs that are six-month programs where you meet every 2 weeks. There's somebody to keep you accountable, to work with you, to help you specifically do some of the lifestyle changes. We can help you get in touch with people to help in different areas. But whatever is right for you, we can help with. And what's right for you probably isn't going to work perfectly for you, because we're all individuals and we all walk the way we are through a different pathway, and our lifestyles are different. So there's no one fix. And that's why doing it properly is hard for mainstream, because there's not do this or do that, and that'll cover everyone. If you have nine people, it might be eight different protocols. And then it's very simple to do. The most important thing, which Brian, this is why I'll introduce Brian in a sec, he is great at explaining this. Well, I'll introduce him now. I've known Brian for a long time. He works for Ortho Molecular. He goes around and he works with doctors to open their mind to what can you do to help the body do what it's trying to do, instead of what can you do to suppress the symptom that the body has. And so he's very good at that, and I figured that would be great for our group to understand why the body isn't regulating properly and what you can do to help the body regulate the blood sugar, not what can I do to force the number down. When you force it down, eventually the problems, like whack-a-mole, the problem will come up here. Whereas if you fix the why, the problem can start going away. So I did the introduction out of order. But the last thing is, and I always go through this, and you probably, those of you that have come to the lectures are tired of hearing it, everything starts in the gut. If digestion isn't working well, and bowel movements aren't good, you're never going to move forward. You're going to keep going back. So if there are digestive or elimination issues, those need to be addressed, because you'll never be able to get really healthy as long as that's out of balance. So we're not talking very much about the gut today or tonight, but that's very, very important. All right, and with that, I'll turn it over to Brian.
Well,
and thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Gary invited me to do this talk for you guys a couple months ago, and I was flattered. I work all throughout the Northeast, from New Jersey all the way up to Maine, Vermont. And I work with practitioners just like Gary all throughout that area. And very few places like Johnson's Compounding, so you guys are actually very, very fortunate to have something like this in your community. And you guys do a really nice job of showing up to these types of events, so you're hungry for the information. So as Gary mentioned, my name's Brian. I work for a company called Ortho Molecular Products, and we manufacture and distribute only to the healthcare practitioner community dietary supplements. Dietary supplements that are manufactured and formulated to the strictest of quality guidelines that are used to produce some type of clinical result, whether it be for blood sugar, allergies, gastrointestinal disorders, you name it. So for the past 11 years, I've been with that company and spent a significant amount of time researching natural medicine mythologies and natural ways to combat some of the most common diseases facing our culture today. And one of the biggest in the area that I feel that I have a lot to offer is a public health crisis around obesity and diabetes, or insulin resistance. So I hope to just educate you on some of the information revolving around those conditions, as well as give you some practical lifestyle modification advice that you could immediately implement into your own life and help to use as part of the therapy, if you do need so. So, Gary mentioned that we're all going to survive the debate, but I don't think one of these two is going to survive after tonight, so take your pick, but I know this is taking place at 9 o'clock, so we'll try to get you out of here in time for you to watch some must-see TV, which has been so far, you know, maybe one of the most bizarre presidential elections ever, so hopefully it continues and we're all entertained one last time. So, here's a slide that basically just lists many different conditions, symptoms. All of these things can generally be contributed to or even addressed by getting control of blood sugar and blood insulin. So we're not going to just focus on blood sugar. We're going to also talk about blood insulin. I'm going to cover that in a little bit. So any of these things we could do a whole separate talk on, and I'm sure Gary has done separate talks on many of these topics up here, but just understand that blood sugar, blood insulin, these are all conditions that could be associated with that. And one of the main reasons is probably because the blood sugar, blood insulin, diabetic epidemic that the country faces is generally a disease of lifestyle. And lifestyle modification is probably one of the most useful ways to treat these conditions or prevent or even slow your progression or reverse your progression. So we're going to talk about therapeutic lifestyle change. So this is just a list of some of the most reputable, well-referenced institutions in medicine. The American Heart Association, American Cancer Society, American Diabetes Association, the National Institutes of Health. These are organizations that are the top of the top, the cream of the crop. And they recommend almost always in any one of these conditions that therapeutic lifestyle change takes front center stage. So they're on board with it. A lot of the time, some of our doctors out there are not always looking at therapeutic lifestyle change. Sometimes patients aren't willing to do the therapeutic lifestyle change. but I hope to show you why lifestyle change is probably the most important and the most effective tool in your own toolbox to combat disease. So first we need to talk about and identify a trend, an epidemic within itself here in the United States, and that's obesity. The obesity rates are climbing, and I have a group of slides that'll basically show trends over the past about 30 years or so of how the obesity rates and state-by-state have climbed. But in the medical community, we use something called the BMI, body mass index. So we determine if a patient is obese, generally by their body mass index. This is something that you could readily look up, any search engine, you could find this out. Basically what we do is we look at your height and we cross-reference that with your weight and you're assigned a number. So if you see towards the top there, there's certain BMIs that fall within a healthy range, some that fall within an overweight range, and then some that will fall within an obese range. So they'll use BMI as a marker or a piece of criteria to determine your health risk. So being obese generally has its own set of health risks, so you have a risk factor right there. So obesity is a major risk factor, and it's a major epidemic here in the United States. One thing to also understand about BMI is it is very black and white, and unfortunately not every individual can be treated as black and white. When you look at, and I'll use a guy like you guys here in New England like, Tom Brady, right? We'll say Tom Brady is 6'5", maybe he weighs 250 pounds. Given by the BMI, he would be deemed obese, but we all know Tom Brady's not obese. He's an elite athlete and probably very trim and in shape. So you have to also take that into account too. But this is what's used by the medical community, and according to the BMI, Tom Brady would be obese, unfortunately. So this are a group of slides put together by the CDC, Center for Disease Control, and they're looking at obesity trends among U.S. adults starting in 1985. So this is the first slide of a group of 25, and what I'm going to do is just basically show you how obesity has grown state by state. Where you see a white state, it means they haven't yet reported data to the CDC. So 1985, data hasn't been reported there. Where you see light blue, it's less than 10% of that state's population was obese. They have a BMI greater than 30. Where there's a darker shade of blue, it's 10 to 14%. Where you start to see that navy blue, 15 to 19%. Yellow, 20 to 24, so on and so forth. You kind of get the idea at this point. So 1985, we're looking, you know, obesity seems to be a little more prevalent here on the East Coast as the West Coast, but maybe not as much as a public health crisis as it's becoming. As we start to move to 1988 from 1985, there's been a pretty drastic shift in obesity in some of these states. 1990, we're seeing most states out of 50, 15 to 19% of their population is obese. As we keep going, you see the trend, 1994.
Is BMI the same for women and men?
BMI for women and men, that is a good question. I believe so. Yeah, I think BMI for women and men are going to be the same. In general, I think they compensate just for the different body types, maybe height and so forth. So yeah. 1996, we're starting to see. So 1997, we start to reach another category where we see yellow. Now 20 to 24% of these states' population is now deemed obese, BMI greater than 30%. We're starting to see more yellow as time goes on, year 2000. And 2001, the first state is now 25 to 29% obese. One out of every four people in the state is obese.
Which one is that?
Mississippi.
Yeah, that's Mississippi. Mississippi is generally the unhealthiest state, so no one here is from Mississippi, right? Is it all right if we pick on Mississippi a little bit? I hope not. All right, so yeah, Mississippi is generally the unhealthiest state, and you actually see there's still one light blue state, and that one light blue state is usually the healthiest state out of all 50, and that's Colorado. Colorado, for whatever reason, tends to have the healthiest population. So the trend continues. Maybe some people from Mississippi moved into Colorado at this point in 2003 because we've shifted over to 15%. Now we're starting to see a lot more states reach the 25%. Now we're seeing greater than 30%.
Isn't that sad?
Yeah. So this is pretty powerful data. I mean, you look at it coming from the Centers for Disease Control. Not only is obesity on the rise, but chronic disease, preventable diseases such as adult onset diabetes, type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance. These are things that are generally preventable with lifestyle. It's a disease of lifestyle in some cases, not always. But we know from these slides that there's an epidemic of lifestyle-related health problems that follow obesity. Some of those that are the well-known are cardiovascular disease. Our blood pressure is up. Our cholesterol has been up. Type 2 diabetes or adult onset diabetes. These are things that generally develop over time and are very much lifestyle-related. Cancer, metabolic syndrome. So one thing you need to understand is these are more prevalent today than they've been years ago, and our genes have not changed. You know, it's not our genes. It's not that my father had cancer, so you know I'm either gonna get cancer or not get cancer, but understand that I have that risk. Or you know my mother had diabetes or type 2 diabetes, so I'm destined to have type 2 diabetes at a certain age. That's not the actual case. What the case is that lifestyle is the root cause of these conditions. And so this is another very medical slide. So I'm going to help you understand this. And these arrows that are on these purple arrows, if you could follow them, it'll greatly help us. So this is a chart of what we call in the medical community the metabolic continuum. So the metabolic continuum is basically your progression into frank disease diagnosis of diabetes. So you'll see this bottom line here. This is the time as it moves forward. This line separating it, the vertical line, is basically where frank disease diagnosis happens. So when I say frank disease diagnosis, you go to the doctor for yearly physical, they check your fasting blood glucose. They notice that your fasting blood glucose is now at 126. The line in the sand has been crossed, 126, and they use the big D word, that you are now a diabetic. So fasting blood glucose reaches 126. That's the line in the sand for diabetes. And that vertical line is where generally the diagnosis happens. So most people kind of live their life not realizing what's taking place on the left side, that vertical line, early on in that metabolic continuum, even though their trajectory is taking them eventually to a diagnosis of diabetes. So most diabetes, again, is diagnosed right there where that purple arrow is pointing into that red shaded area, which will be frank disease diagnosis. So what's happening on the left side? What leads us to this point? Well, it starts in the pancreas, and Gary mentioned this before. That the pancreas is an organ that's responsible to produce the hormone insulin. So when there's a constant demand for insulin, so if you're abusing the pancreas, think of it this way, if you're constantly eating high glycemic index foods, which we'll discuss, ingesting a lot of sugary drinks, colas, those types of things, there's a high demand for insulin. Think of it as a rubber band. The rubber band stretches, goes back to normal. Rubber band stretches, go back to normal. This is your pancreas. Rubber band finally stretches to a point where it breaks. It can no longer produce the amount of insulin that's necessary. Sometimes you lose complete pancreatic beta cell function where insulin production is completely compromised, and then that's where you're an insulin-dependent diabetic or maybe a type 1 diabetic. So this is what's taking place on the left side over time, early on. And this is where I talk about blood sugar. We all think about blood sugar, but blood insulin is really just as important and something that we should be looking at early on, and something that maybe you can ask your doctors to take a look at if they're not already. But we see how insulin, pancreatic insulin production, although blood fasting glucose generally isn't moving, you're in the normal range here, but your insulin levels are actually climbing. So this is a marker of your trajectory. You know, you're putting a lot of load on the pancreas to take care of all the blood sugar that you're in, or the sugar that you're ingesting. And over time, you may sacrifice the pancreas because of it. Looking further on, obviously, I may have mentioned this already, but the pancreas can lose its pancreas. The beta cells within the pancreas are what are responsible to produce insulin. So over time, constant demand for insulin, you keep beating and beating the pancreas. Eventually, you will lose your pancreatic beta cell function. And that's really the key to it all, people. Pancreatic beta cell function in diabetes, if you can preserve that, then you'll be able to preserve your insulin, your ability to make insulin, and you can prevent some serious complications over time. Another thing, heart disease complication. So it follows the insulin production. All along, keep in mind, our blood sugar is normal. We're getting our blood sugar checked every year at our physical. And the doctor says, your blood sugar looks normal to me. It's around 90-something. But what's going on here that we might not be discovering is our insulin levels are increasing. So our insulin levels are increasing. We're developing insulin resistance. When I say insulin resistance, it means that your cells in the body are now becoming resistant to the production of insulin, the presence of insulin. So blood sugar's there. The cell signals out, hey, there's sugar. Pancreas create the insulin. I need the insulin to help drive it into my cell. And those cells are resistant to the presence of insulin. So you need more and more and more insulin in order to actually absorb those sugars. So heart disease and the complications follow your insulin production and your insulin resistance. Protecting the heart. You know, you have to understand the connection between blood sugar and blood insulin. So that would probably be one of the major takeaways of this talk. Blood sugar, blood insulin. And people don't die of diabetes. They generally die of the complications of diabetes. They die of, you know, heart attacks, strokes, other things, that the comorbidities that follow. So let's take a look back at lifestyle interventions and some of the research that's available. One of the most compelling pieces of research is that I think you guys might agree with when you're looking at your diabetic patients. So this was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. So New England Journal of Medicine is probably considered one of the most prestigious medical journals in the world, well respected amongst the medical community. They did a long-term trial looking at the reduction in the incidence of type 2 diabetics with lifestyle intervention or the drug metformin. You guys heard of the drug metformin before?
Yeah.
Metformin is probably the most common drug written for patients with blood sugar issues. It's a good drug. It tends to do its job. So this was deemed the DPP trial, Diabetes Prevention Program. So they looked at pre-diabetic patients. They split them into three groups. So patients who are generally on their way to frank disease diagnosis, frank diabetes. And they split them into three groups. One group, a placebo. What they did with this group was basically just kind of let them flow along the normal lifestyle that pop culture would take them. Didn't really give them any advice, just kind of people who were just taking, you know, their own health in their own hands and following recommendations of pop culture. One group took metformin. One group was prescribed lifestyle change. It was a 7% reduction in body weight and 150 minutes of light activity per week was their prescription, which is the equivalent of 30 minutes of walking 5 days a week. So they were prescribed to walk 30 minutes 5 days a week and lose about 7% of your body weight. So after 4 years, they examined the populations for who developed diabetes. Out of these three groups, who were the most that developed diabetes? Well, as predicted, the placebo group developed the most cases of diabetes. So these patients have advanced from being a pre-diabetic into a diabetic. The metformin group was 31% less. So they took metformin, they were able to manage their blood sugar, they were able to manage their progression into frank disease diagnosis. However, the lifestyle group, which was 150 minutes of walking per week, 7% reduction in body weight, lots of those patients actually were not compliant on the body weight, unfortunately. But the 150 minutes of walking per week had almost double the reduction of the progression into diabetes over the most popular drug, which is metformin. So this just shows you that when looking at preventing diabetes or kind of reversing your trend or your trajectory into diabetes, that nothing is more powerful than lifestyle, not even the most commonly prescribed drug for the condition. So lifestyle medicine is powerful. We all have a genetic predisposition, although your genes are not going to determine. You're not doomed by what your genes tell you. Whether it's diabetes, my dad had diabetes, you're not deemed to have adult onset diabetes because my father had diabetes. It's basically a combination of your lifestyle that you lead with your genes. So you'll see the first picture here is a gentleman eating a nice roast beef sandwich. You know, that in combination with the genes that might be more predisposed to these conditions gives you more risk. It gives you more disposition, or you're more disposed to disease. The lady on the bottom, she's eating a huge chunk of broccoli with her genes, which gives her less risk, less disease. So even though, let's say both of these genes here, his genes, her genes, both have diabetes, cancer in their family, she's reducing her less risk through a lifestyle modification approach. And in this situation is diet. And really some of the reasons behind it, and a lot of the dietary trends out there focus on carbohydrates. We've really vilified carbohydrates. We've done a really good job of vilifying carbohydrates as a country. The Atkins diet, no carbs, you know, and now we're the paleo diet where you're very selective carbs. But there's a such thing as good carbs and there's a such thing as bad carbs. So what makes a good carb good? Here's an example of a good carb, an apple. Pieces of fruit are generally good carbs. So they contain a good amount of sugar in them, but they don't cause the blood sugar to spike like a bad carb like white bread does. Because an apple, although it does have a lot of sugar in it, it contains fiber, it contains other nutrients, it may contain protein, other things contain fats in them, which actually slow the absorption of sugar. So carbs turn into sugar, right? So a good carb will contain other things that'll slow your absorption, will slow the release of that sugar into the body. So it almost becomes like a slow trickle. Pancreas really likes good carbs. Pancreas really hates bad carbs because bad carbs are like your refined white breads. There's not much to them other than just refined carbohydrates, which quickly get converted to sugar, and they drop a sugar bomb into the body. Pancreas doesn't like that. Your blood sugar spikes, your insulin spikes. Constant demand. Here's another example of a bad carb. A Coke or a Pepsi or an RC Cola, whatever that might be. So this is basically, there's nothing to it. This is water. This is high fructose corn syrup. It's sugar, water, and you're basically just dropping a sugar bomb. It's quickly absorbed into the blood. And again, your pancreas does not like this. Here's something that generally we look at as healthy. But we need to start examining these types of foods a little closer, and you want to start to be able to read a label. But cereals, and a lot of these cereals tout how they are healthy. One bowl a day, and you get all your vitamins and your nutrients, and it's a great way to start your day. Unfortunately, they're usually not made in a way where they're the perfect ratio of nutrients in them. So they tend to have either a lot of sugar, and if they're very low in sugar, they tend to have a lot of carbohydrates, not a lot of fiber, not a lot of protein. So again, sugar bomb goes off in the body, and we need to really start avoiding the bad carbs, start introducing more of these good carbs into the diet. Here's a pretty cool slide. Gets a little complicated, so just follow with me. So this looked at the number and percentage of the U.S. population diagnosed with diabetes over a period of time, and it looked at the year 1958 all the way to 2010. And you see through the years, you know, we had a relatively stable incline of the incidence of diabetics in the United States. But then you look into the 90s, around the 95, mid-90s, you see a sudden surge. And why is that? And it really can be associated, and there's research that really supports this, not only in the United States, but in other countries where high fructose corn syrup has been introduced. But there was a sudden surge in using the sweetener high fructose corn syrup in in a lot of the common foods that are ingested here in the United States. So you see high fructose corn syrup in probably too many things at the supermarket, and they could really be attributed to that sugar bomb that goes off in the body and puts a constant load on the pancreas. So eliminating sugary drinks, foods with high fructose corn syrup, I would say avoid them altogether. There's other types of sweeteners out there that don't spike your blood sugar, that don't put a load on the pancreas, that you could swap out for these high fructose corn syrup things. But try to get used to reading the labels, and when you see high fructose corn syrup in there as an ingredient, I would say it's good advice to try to avoid that product and maybe replace it with something else. So here's something I mentioned before, glycemic index. So the glycemic index is basically, it's basically how a food influences your blood sugar and your insulin levels. So look at an Idaho potato. It's basically a white starch. It's quickly converted to sugar by the body. So it's got a very high glycemic index. Corn flakes, pretzels, things like jelly beans, which are basically straight sugar, are very high glycemic index because the body can convert them quickly to sugar, and they raise your blood sugar, spike your blood sugar, followed by a spike in insulin. So they put this constant demand on the pancreas. By the way, glycemic index is something that you can find. It's readily available on any search engine. So I recommend getting on Google if this is something you want. You get a pretty extensive list and look at foods. And really what you want to do is avoid the high glycemic index foods and try to target more of these lower glycemic index foods. Here's an example of, you know, we all go out to dinner from time to time, and I'm sure we all enjoy potatoes or mashed potatoes or something like that. Something you could easily swap out is that Idaho potato with a sweet potato. Believe it or not, a sweet potato tastes sweet, right? You would think it actually has a higher glycemic index, but it actually has a much lower, almost half the glycemic index of an Idaho potato. And that's because it contains, much like an apple, right? It contains fiber, it contains other nutrients in it that slow the absorption of the sugar. Where the Idaho potato is just kind of stripped down starch, converts quick to sugar.
I was wondering, is there maybe anything, other parts of the food that could offset the glycemic load?
Yeah.
So maybe it has a high glycemic, but it's got other things that kind of balance it out.
Yeah. So like if you were to look at a bagel, you may be able to find bagels. There's a trend in a food, but it's made by a major food company called Fiber One. You guys, I'm sure, have heard of Fiber One products. They make all types of bread products. Basically, they fortify their foods with fiber. And what fiber does is it's that macronutrient that slows the absorption of the carbohydrates. It slows the absorption of sugar, so it's not a sudden surge of sugar. You get more of that slow trickle, and that slow trickle is actually very healthy on the body, and I'll show you what I mean by that. But yeah, absolutely. And, you know, even looking at the low glycemic index foods, carrots, very sweet, right? But they contain other things. Apples, you know, very, very sweet, but they contain other things. You put apple juice on here, it becomes a high glycemic index food, because then you've basically taken that apple and you remove the water and the sugar. And there's no fiber left in it. There's nothing left in it to slow the absorption of that sugar. So again, definitely something worth having. Maybe hanging. Sure.
I recently was reading about the potato diet.
Okay.
It doesn't seem to make any sense to me. I was just wondering if.
I'm not familiar with the potato diet.
Maybe an Irishman diet.
What's that?
Made by an Irishman?
It may be.
Well, it was, you know, the Penn and Teller, I think it was Penn, he went on that diet and he lost like 100 pounds or something.
Is that right?
Okay.
And it was white Idaho potatoes?
All forms of potatoes.
Okay.
Now, that could also be, depending upon how you're eating, you could be almost starving the body.
Right.
So you start, one thing you have to be careful when you're trying to lose body mass is, are you using the starting to digest and use the layer of fat, or if you go on a two-week fast, a lot of what you lose is water and your protein, your muscles, and then when you start eating, you rebuild it. So a lot of times you can lose the weight and then it goes right back on when you start eating. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a bunch of diets out there. It's more, going back to what Brian was saying, lifestyle. If you can get, I don't like using the word diet, if you get on an eating habit that you can live with the rest of your life, then you're not on a diet. And something like the South Beach diet, it just teaches, it reminds us how we're supposed to eat, and you get your metabolic rate up, and you're burning fat. I'll just throw something in. The cellular level, we were designed to use fats first, protein second, and carbs third for energy. The healthy fats are the best source of energy for our metabolic rate. What's happened is we reversed it. We're carbs, protein, and then fats, because fats got a bad rap because the man-made fats were killing us.
Yeah.
So we just lumped all the fats in. So the body needs the right fuels to work right, so you can lose weight by eating wrong. Okay,
yeah.
Sorry.
No, thank you. I think two healthy lifestyle medicine tips that we've learned so far, low glycemic index. We know we can get that readily available through the internet. And exercise prescription, from what we've seen, was 150 minutes of walking per week. 150 minutes of walking per week. So those are two things that I would highly recommend. So managing blood sugar, basically what this is showing you is a chart on blood sugar levels that are healthy. When you have blood sugar that is too high, you store fat. When you have blood sugar that is too low, the body will store fat. So here to the left, we have blood sugar levels, and here on the bottom, this is over the duration of time. So an apple actually has, as I mentioned several times, has more things than sugar in it. So it has a very slow, steady blood sugar release. It's not just suddenly rushing blood sugar into the blood, or sugar into the blood. So it actually has a nice even keel. This is how you want your blood sugar to actually flow throughout the day, throughout when you're eating. High glycemic index foods cause a sudden surge. They cause a spike in blood sugar. White potato, surge. White bread, Coke, surge in blood sugar. The alarm goes off. And insulin is recruited. The pancreas needs to secrete the insulin, and it generally raises insulin to a level that's higher than what's present in blood sugar. And what happens there is the insulin, when functioning properly, drives the blood sugar down. It drives it down to a point where you've actually become hypoglycemic, and you start to crave food again. So if you've ever maybe had for lunch a couple slices of pizza or something that would be considered a high glycemic food, and a half hour later you're just crashing. You're crashing and you're hungry again. And generally that's because your blood sugar has spiked from the meal and now it's back on its way down. So it falls to a point where you become hypoglycemic, you're tired now, you're still craving food, you might be craving more carbohydrates, and it's the liver's responsibility to bring the blood sugar back up when it gets to that point. So the liver stores glucose. The liver stores glucose and it releases it when the body is in a hypoglycemic state. So when your blood sugar is too high, that's when we start to develop fat. Excess blood sugar generally gets converted to fat. Obviously your diabetes risk goes up when you have high blood sugar, but high belly fat is another risk factor for diabetes. Fatty liver disease. We see now how blood sugar and insulin affects the liver. Cholesterol. Excess sugar gets converted to fat. Triglycerides. Another risk factor for diabetes. And inflammation goes up. So here's a roller coaster ride of blood sugar throughout the day and how it can occur. So remember how even-keeled eating an apple kept us right in the zone that you want to be. So you weren't ingesting too much sugar, and you weren't falling below. So we start our day with a healthy bowl of cereal. It spikes your blood sugar, and you're well above. The alarm goes off, insulin needs to be dumped, and we drive that blood sugar down. Now you're thinking to yourself, you know, I was good today. I had my Special K, and I'm going to treat myself with a granola bar. Granola bars are, you know, basically the equivalent of candy bars these days when you look at the amount of sugar that's in them. So you go and you have a granola bar. What happens? Your blood sugar spikes, and the alarm goes off. Then again, you the pancreas is responsible to produce that insulin to get that blood sugar under control. And you're thinking to yourself, hey, I had my Special K today. I was good. I had only had a granola bar. I'm going to treat myself with a chocolate bar or the candy bar. And then again, you know, blood sugar spikes, alarm goes off, pancreas is responsible to control that with insulin production. So it really is a vicious cycle, and this is how easy it is to get your blood sugar out of control, and it's the cumulative effect of these types of things. It's not one day, it's not 2 days, it's years, it's months that causes the issue. So just key points, these high glycemic foods, which we've identified, these trigger those insulin, those alarms within the pancreas. High insulin, high blood sugar is going to lead to fat storage. Long-term high insulin is going to be linked to insulin resistance. Eventually, the cells will be used to the presence of insulin, and insulin won't be able to do its job. And insulin resistance over time leads to type 2 diabetes.
What about low blood sugar over long term?
Low blood sugar generally will have an effect, it'll have a negative effect. But generally, they need to be addressed by probably more small, frequent meals. You can store fat that way. Depending on the reason for hypoglycemia, you know, there are different ways to address it.
So there's a pancreatic problem?
With low blood sugar? Generally, no. Generally, no, just because when looking at the way that insulin is released, it's in the response to sugar being present. So if you have glycemic index foods that are very high, you're going to really spike your insulin. So you're spiking your glucose, then you're going to spike your insulin, and you're going to drive the glucose down. And then your glucose is now down where the liver has to bring it back up. So you're hypoglycemic. So over time, you know, depending on your reason for hypoglycemia, you could have an issue with the liver if it's because of lifestyle reasons due to diet, because there's a lot of high glycemic index foods, then yeah, of course you'll put burden on the pancreas too. So keeping your blood sugar in that zone, that's that low glycemic index foods, that's where you want it, that's the hot zone. This is where you can burn fat, you don't store fat, you don't gain a lot of fat, there's not a tremendous amount of weight gain here. And you have less insulin resistance because the pancreas can handle blood sugar that enters the body in this fashion. Less insulin resistance, less risk for diabetes, and less inflammation. So four steps. We'll give you four steps to moving forward for your blood sugar and your blood insulin balance. First and foremost, determine your risks. So these can be done, obviously, with blood sugar markers, whether it's fasting glucose, HbA1c, triglycerides. These are things that medicine looks at to determine your risk factors for diabetes. So know where you are. Know where your risk factors are. Set personalized targets where you want your blood sugar, your insulin, your weight, your lipid levels. Where do you want them to be? You've identified a starting point. Now where do we move to improve those? Implement lifestyle medicine. Even if it's just starting with walking, you don't have to do high-intensity training. Just general walking can have a profound effect on progression into diabetes. You can track your progress. You do that with your physicians. Gary can help you track progress as well with programs that he has in place. So there's something called the insulin resistance score calculation that maybe Gary can help you with or your physician. and you can find out where you are. And if you remember the metabolic continuum chart, it was that graph that showed the progression of disease over time. This is going to help you figure out where you are on the left side. So before you get to diabetes, find out where you are on the left side, your progression. Diet, physical activity, questionnaires. This can really help you identify where you are, and then you can set goals that based upon that. I'm sure Gary can help you with those as well. We talked about setting targets for risk reduction. So around weight reduction, the diabetes prevention program looked at reducing 7% of your body weight. Waist circumference is a risk factor for diabetes. They'll actually take a tape measure out, measure your waist circumference, and if you fall within a certain range, that's actually a risk factor for diabetes. These are other markers: blood sugar, glycated hemoglobin, HbA1c. HbA1c is generally it's a picture of where your blood sugar is over time, so it's a useful marker, and I'm sure that's a marker that some of you have seen before. Further planning and implementing a risk reduction strategy, dietary pattern recommendations. So we're going to look at low glycemic impact. We're going to increase our fiber, and smaller frequent meals are generally the better way to go. You don't want to overeat at a meal because you put too much burden, again, on the pancreas, you spike your blood sugar. Eating breakfast. If you don't eat breakfast and you start skipping meals, that's how you get the vicious cycle of overeating. You depend on caffeine. You depend maybe more on foods that you shouldn't eat, foods that are more high glycemic. Eliminate sugary beverages, even if this is your first step. No more Cokes. That could be a really big deal for you guys to move forward here. Physical activity recommendations, again, 150 minutes per week of walking. You know, generally something that some of us could easily achieve. Additional recommendations, stress management, something that Gary's very well versed in, has done talks in the past, and sleeping. You know, sleeping is where the body restores itself. So if you're not sleeping, you're gonna have a rough time in many situations. Talking about diet, looking more specifically at what diet should you do, there's tons of diets out there. There is the Atkins diet, where there's no carbs. There's a paleo diet, where it's the paleo diet. And then there's the Mediterranean diet, which I'm sure you guys have heard of. But this is the most scientifically proven diet. This diet has actually shown, if you follow the Mediterranean dietary pattern, that it reduces your risk for all-cause death. You live longer when you eat like a Mediterranean. And generally, why is that? Well, the Mediterraneans, if you see on the bottom, they're physical. They take more time with meals. Meals become more of a social thing. They don't rush and eat. And they have less stress, and they're positive people generally. Mostly based on fruits, vegetables, some grains, mostly whole grains and oils, healthy oils like olive oils. Fish and seafood make up a large part of their diet. And you see at the top, meat, sweets, poultry, eggs, cheese, yogurt. These make up a lot less, and they do occasionally mix in wine. So wine is something that's also allowed on the Mediterranean diet. So a lot of people don't have a problem eating this way when they realize they can have a glass of wine. So to further just elaborate on nutritional recommendations that are the most scientifically validated when looking at blood sugar, blood insulin, the Mediterranean diet, and in combination with low glycemic diets. These help with improving insulin sensitivity, reduce your need for insulin, reduce your cholesterol, reduce fat, increase the good cholesterol, overall improve blood sugar, blood insulin function. And again, movement's medicine. It doesn't have to be, CrossFit. It doesn't have to be, run a marathon. Start somewhere. Start walking a little bit each day. Work your way up to something. But every little bit is going to make a big difference. And step four, you could track your progress. You could, with regular follow-up appointments. And these are things, you need a certain level of accountability when you implement these types of things. And people like Gary are here to do that for you. Your doctor could do that for you. Make adjustments to protocols and help you be more successful. So we're going to talk quickly about targeted nutrients for cardiometabolic disease. Nutrients that are more specific to improving blood insulin, blood sugar numbers, and the way that the body is able to metabolize these in a very healthy way. So these are just some of the things that in the medical community that are measured when looking at people's risk factors, real risk factors for diabetes. These are different organizations from the American Heart Association, American Diabetes Association, but I'll point out metabolic syndrome because metabolic syndrome is again a public health crisis here in the United States. One out of every three American has metabolic syndrome. And metabolic syndrome is basically you are positive for three of five criteria. Doesn't matter which three of the five, but it's fasting blood glucose if it's over 100. If you have triglyceride levels that are greater than 150, if your HDL cholesterol is less than 40 for a male, 50 for a female, if your blood pressure is greater than 130 over 85 or one of the other, your waist circumference is over 40 for a male, 35 for a female, so three of those five, and you actually have an increased risk for developing diabetes. You're deemed metabolic syndrome, you have insulin resistance most likely, and it doesn't mean that your future is determined, it just means that you have to be more proactive at this point to reverse your trend, because your trajectory, if looking at that metabolic continuum chart, is headed to the right. So we need to either bring it back to the left or stall it in its place. And it's possible with lifestyle modification, it's possible with the right nutrients. As Gary mentioned, just like a soup, sprinkling the right ingredients makes all the difference. Look at the American Heart Association recommendations, though, for metabolic syndrome. So they almost always recommend drugs. Okay, so that's probably the first thing that the doctor recommends. But they also recommend 150 minutes of exercise a week, walking, all from that New England Journal of Medicine study I showed you before, and to lose 7% of your body weight typically. So think of the cell's ability or the body's ability to dispose of sugar like a sump pump. You've seen these sump pumps before, I hope. So this makes sense for you, but water enters, it's responsible to take it out, remove it. That's basically how it works within the body with blood sugar. Over time, you constantly get rained on. The sump pump just can't keep up with it anymore. Maybe it's not working as efficiently as it did. And you're starting to actually see that the levels of blood sugar, in this case water, are rising to the point where your body's now flooded, or your basement's now flooded. So now you need more of a serious intervention. It's time to intervene, and we need to clean the water out. We need to clean the blood sugar out. The problem is, modern medicine, very good at this. We could write you a prescription. It'll get your blood sugar under control. But we still have damage that water did. So if you see here, the damage to the basement is the mildew, the floor needed to be ripped out, everything, you know, has been damaged. And it has not actually been repaired. So there's certain nutrients that will actually help repair the metabolic function of the cell. It'll repair the cell's ability to metabolize blood sugar and convert it to energy, which it's supposed to do. So there's two supplements that I'll point out that Gary uses extensively here and has very good success with. And the first is CM Core. CM Core is three ingredients, vitamin C, berberine, and alpha-lipoic acid. We're going to key in on berberine and alpha-lipoic acid for a second, because these are two, I would say, pillar nutrients for any patient with metabolic syndrome, insulin resistance, or diabetes. So basically what it does, it works very similar to metformin without the side effects. So it activates the master metabolic regulator, which is for short called AMPK. This is an enzyme that's involved in increasing your metabolism. So by increasing your metabolism, you're basically taking things and converting it to energy. So sugar basically is used by the body for energy. So there's a breakdown over time where your metabolism slows and you're not taking that sugar, you're not converting to energy, and it's causing problems. So metformin activates AMPK, berberine activates AMPK. In fact, berberine is a natural ingredient, it's from a plant, and it's been compared to metformin in several studies. Here's one study that looked at berberine in type 2 diabetic patients, and they split them into three groups. But here they're just looking at two groups. The other group was in a drug class called Avandia, which isn't commonly used anymore. But here they used 1 gram of berberine compared to 1.5 grams of metformin. And they measured fasting glucose, their HbA1c, and their triglycerides. And they found that the berberine actually worked just as well as the metformin without any of the side effects. So this is pretty exciting stuff.
Would you take both?
Metformin and berberine. Mm-hmm. So the thing with metformin is it doesn't cause a hypoglycemic event, neither does berberine. So you can take both, but I would always consult, probably with Gary would be the best person, just to kind of see what levels of medication you're taking. But yeah, you could take both, and they do work in a similar fashion. Question?
What are the side effects of metformin?
Metformin has 1 out of every 3 patients don't tolerate metformin due to gastrointestinal side effects. So GI complaints that are, you know, more digestive things.
You can get extended release, which works better.
Yep.
Yeah, a lot of people get bad diarrhea or loose stools, and then if you think of the transit time in the bowel, if everything's flying through, you're not absorbing the metformin well,
right.
So a lot of times they just give you more metformin.
Yeah.
And so there are alternatives. Or a lot of times we have people who are using a combination. You can, working with your doctor, lower the metformin, adding the berberine in, get the same effect at a lower dose of a pharmaceutical. Most side effects are dose related.
Yeah, and they make an extended release now, which you brought up, which is a good point, which generally they've created to help deal with some of those side effects.
Yeah, but he also just brought up a good point. If you're not absorbing it,
yeah,
you know, if you have the runs, then you're not absorbing the medication anyway.
Yeah, it kind of moves right through you.
What's the significance of vitamin C?
The vitamin C is in there. It almost acts as a preservative. Yeah. So when you have things that are in a capsule, sometimes they, almost everything in a capsule, whether it's a drug or a supplement, they degrade over time. So raw materials degrade over time. So you put things in there. Sometimes you'll put things in there to help stabilize the raw material, especially if it's a little more volatile and more prone to degrade. So just looking at berberine, it also helps with cholesterol. Here's a study that looked at 32 patients with high cholesterol, and they used 1 gram of berberine a day. And the equivalent of what we're doing here with CMCOR decreased serum cholesterol by 29%, triglycerides by 35%, and LDL by 25%, all by activating AMPK. Another study here looking at berberine in type 2 diabetics basically looked at 1,500 milligrams per day, but compared with metformin, berberine exhibited an identical effect in the regulation of glucose metabolism, HbA1c, fasting blood glucose, fasting insulin, and postprandial insulin. Berberine produced better results in lipid metabolism, triglycerides, and total cholesterol.
Yeah.
So there's something that actually exists that works as well as the most commonly prescribed drug for that condition. Combine that with lifestyle modification, you have a really powerful protocol, because we saw how lifestyle compares to metformin. Now we're starting to see how some of these nutrients actually compare to metformin.
Can I ask about the effect of on the cholesterol level? If you're taking a statin and you take this berberine, and you're also lowering your cholesterol, is there such a thing as having too little cholesterol, too low? I've heard of that.
Yeah.
I think it affects your hormones.
Yeah, absolutely. So there is a such thing as too little cholesterol, although, you know, most drug companies want to drive
it
down.
If you, if you have an incident, they'll. I'm thinking specifically of my mother who had reasonable cholesterol mm-hmm. and did have a heart problem, and they gave her a huge amount of statin, and I know that it takes it way, way down, and she became tired, mm-hmm. The side effects of that. Also, I think some of the supplements, I have some feelings about that, mm-hmm. but now she's on these, like a heavy statin regimen, and yeah. she was dead set against them. She wasn't ever going to take that stuff.
Yeah.
But now I think it's almost overdone. I just have some questions about the cumulative effects, and if you're just stripping your body of stuff that makes it work.
Because
your brain is cholesterol, and
yeah.
you don't want to get fogged out.
Yeah. Cholesterol is
it's
necessary. It's actually all the hormones in the body are created from cholesterol. There's a lot of things that are created from cholesterol. You don't want to have zero cholesterol. There's a such thing as good cholesterol, mm-hmm. and you need a healthy amount of cholesterol.
What's the healthy amount?
Well, I would say you don't want to have a cholesterol that's extremely low. It's a hard thing to quantify. There's some people who believe cholesterol is actually overblown, and it's not as much as a risk factor as we originally thought. A lot of the guidelines now are just to reduce it below 100. They're always kind of setting the line lower and lower. Lower for cholesterol, but I'm not sure that we're seeing mortality following those guidelines. So it's a hard thing to quantify what would be a healthy level of cholesterol.
They're also now looking at, it used to be total cholesterol.
Mm-hmm.
Now they're looking, you might say someone might have a total cholesterol of 210, mm-hmm. but the doctor says, don't worry about it. Your HDL, the helper, the good one, is high. The bad cholesterol is low. Your ratio is better than someone that has a cholesterol, total cholesterol of 180, but has a high LDL. Mm-hmm. Now they're looking at the real ultra low fractions. So they've realized, as he said, it's a marker. It's not a life sentence.
Mm-hmm.
So you could have a high cholesterol level. But if your ratio is good, your lifestyle is good, it probably isn't a risk factor. But you can have a lower cholesterol and be a couch potato
mm-hmm.
and have a lot of belly fat, and you're in real danger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's not, again, one thing. It's looking at the whole picture.
Is any of these products increase good cholesterol?
Increase good cholesterol? So, generally, no. That's not the way they're going to work. Yeah, there's very few things that actually will increase reliably. This is something that you'll see time and time again in the natural world that'll increase HDL cholesterol, with the exception of niacin. So niacin, time and time again, there's even a drug form of niacin, but it's actually cheaper to buy a supplement because they're actually our niacin is made by the same company that makes the prescription form. And we sell it for a fraction of the price because the drug form of niacin is really not well covered by insurances. So that's something that you could use reliably to increase HDL cholesterol. Just find a time-release niacin, because one of the most common side effects, the most common call to the poison control center is actually from a niacin flush. I don't know if you guys have ever experienced a niacin flush. But it freaks people out when they don't expect it. But it's a normal thing associated with niacin. So find something that's a good time release, extended release, and it should work really well for you.
That's niacin. I want
niacin. Yeah, we make one.
It's costly.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We make one. It's a time release niacin. Same company. Maybe Gary can help you out and give you some advice on how to divert some of the costs around for you.
Is there also exercise that increases the...
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Exercise, lifestyle modification, anywhere you are in that metabolic continuum. If you're healthy, if you can stand to lose some weight, if you're metabolic syndrome, if you're type 2 diabetic, anywhere you insert lifestyle modification, you will improve every marker and every outcome. So lifestyle modification, whether it's exercise, low glycemic index, Mediterranean diet, that'll help to make a shift in good cholesterol too.
So is the key metabolism, increasing your metabolism?
Drugs target certain pathways, right? And AMPK is one of them. And that's what berberine targets as well. And that's how berberine works. What we're seeing is berberine tends to work just as well as metformin. And then there's drugs target another pathway, oral drugs target another pathway called PIK3, which is a signaling pathway that allows sugar to enter the cell. So I'll show you that in another slide. But that's one way. I mean, think about metabolic syndrome. It's a condition of poor metabolism, right? We're starting to get wider waist circumference. Our cholesterol is going up. Our blood sugar is going up. We're not metabolizing these things as we once did. So key is really targeting AMPK, which is the major metabolic switch that controls metabolism.
The exercise is good because it increases the metabolism and helps you break down the food. Mm-hmm. But some kids will exercise and still eat a lot of junk.
Oh, yeah.
And they won't gain weight.
Yeah.
But then it becomes habitual.
Isn't it nice to be young?
Yeah.
I mean, is that the essence of the exercise? Is just to break down the food?
Well, you know, I guess if they're the young kid, right, and they're exercising, and they're probably exercising pretty rigorously, but they're actually able to eat nothing but refined carbs and
right.
Cokes, and they,
right.
you know, they look like they're in perfect shape,
right.
It's because their body's able to handle that.
Right.
So kind of go back to the rubber band. So they stretch the rubber band, but it's returning to its normal size.
Right.
So they're metabolizing all this. The,
right.
the blood sugar spikes, but the insulin knocks it right down,
right.
and the cell in a very healthy way is dealing with that.
Mm-hmm.
But once they age and they keep doing that, and you know, eventually it catches up to us, so you'll stretch that rubber band to a point where now it doesn't return to its normal size.
Even if they're exercising still?
Even if they're exercising, yeah. I mean, you can only eat like that to a certain, you know, age.
Yeah.
And, all this stuff does catch up. But yeah, I know some people like that as
yeah.
well, and it definitely can be rough.
How about the stress factors?
Mm-hmm.
Do they relation to your waist circumference?
Oh yeah. So stress hormones play a big role there. The stress hormone cortisol. I don't want to get off too much of a tangent, but the stress hormone cortisol is what's released from the adrenal glands in response to stress, is a glucocorticoid. So it's involved in glucose, right? Glucocorticoid. So it has to be thought that way. So when you, high-index foods, right, the glycemic index foods spike your blood sugar, and they drop down to you become hypoglycemic, it's a stress response. It's a stress on the body. And cortisol is released from the adrenal gland, and it actually helps the liver raise blood sugar levels. So that's another big issue. So you need to get, you know, your stress levels in order. Your stress levels need to be somewhat maintained in a healthy way in order to manage weight and fat loss effectively. Cool. So alpha-lipoic acid was the other ingredient that I mentioned. So if you're going to take one ingredient in your diabetic patient, I would say alpha-lipoic acid is probably a must. Alpha-lipoic acid is a pillar nutrient for any patient struggling with blood sugar, blood insulin issues. It's because it works on the front end of the disease, where it actually helps with insulin sensitivity. It improves the glucose uptake, it sensitizes the cell to the presence of insulin. The research has shown it time and time again. Here it shows it's in one study, 600 milligrams significantly improved, significant improvement in glucose disposal and insulin sensitivity in type 2 diabetic patients. But associated with diabetes is an increase in free radicals. There's a lot of oxidation that takes place because you bathe the cells in sugar. Think of it almost like rust. It's salt water on metal. Over time, you cause a lot of oxidation. Alpha-lipoic acid is a very versatile antioxidant because it could recharge water-soluble vitamin C, fat-soluble vitamin E, the body's own antioxidant that's created in the body is called glutathione, recharges that, and it itself can scavenge a free radical. So it's a very, very potent and powerful antioxidant, and it could actually help offset some of the effects of high blood sugar, high insulin.
So once,
can I
say something?
Sure.
Once you've been deemed, diabetic, mm-hmm. and not pre-diabetic, this would help just because it would, not only with the free radicals, but it would, for your glycemic index, it would keep it more steady?
It'll help the cells still dispose of your glucose in a healthy fashion. It'll help the cell become more sensitive to the presence of insulin. So the cell doesn't necessarily need to be bathed, and they're always calling the pancreas for insulin. It's still beneficial in that situation too.
And does metformin and or berberine? Berberine. Okay. Berberine. Does it do a similar situation? In other words, does metformin, mm-hmm. which berberine is close to metformin?
Yeah.
Does that also have the same effect of preserving the cell, the beta cell, and insulin resistance? I mean, is there ALL in metformin? Is
no.
what I'm trying to ask you.
No. Separate ingredient altogether. So metformin is, just think of it as a synthetic drug that's been created to just target this one pathway and shift it.
But what is the pathway? The pathway is insulin resistance. It's maintaining your insulin, correct? Not to have it fluctuate.
Yeah, but it does that in a certain fashion. So alpha lipoic acid works a little differently than berberine and metformin. But if you kind of look again to the master metabolic regulator AMPK, and this is what we're targeting, mm-hmm. AMPK activates these three pathways. So I don't want to get too technical, but PGC1 alpha is involved with the mitochondria. And the mitochondria are the engine in every cell. Mitochondria is where all the energy of the cell is produced. It needs fuel. Generally, the fuel that it uses is glucose and fat. So by activating this pathway, you increase the glucose uptake, you increase metabolism, so basically you're converting this to energy. Metabolism is a process of creating energy. GLUT4, which I actually have a diagram which I'll show you, AMPK activates GLUT4. This is a protein that lies dormant within the cell. That metformin, that berberine activates. When it activates, it rises to the surface of the cell, and it's almost like the door. Think of insulin as the key, GLUT4 is the door open. And the door opens, and it receives, and it takes in the glucose. The third is acetyl-CoA, which is involved in fat synthesis. So triglyceride synthesis, fatty acid oxidation, it actually influences that pathway as well, because when there's too much glucose, the body needs to do something with it, so it basically converts it to fat. And it converts it to triglycerides, mainly. That's why you see your triglycerides go up as a risk factor in diabetic patients or people at risk for. And that just means you have a higher fat content in your blood. So the triglyceride is basically fat cells in the blood.
What is
our
alpha-lipoic?
There's multiple forms. There's R and there's RS, alpha-lipoic acid. R alpha-lipoic acid, I believe, Gary, my alpha-lipoic acid R in the RS form. I'm not too sure what the RS stands for.
Is it different? The levorotor, it's the way it rotates light when they look at it. So it's sort of... It's a mirror image of it. Mm-hmm. And so for different things or different activities in the body, one form is more effective than the other.
It's not better necessarily. It's just
it depends upon what you're trying to do.
I'm pretty sure it's more expensive.
Yes, it is.
So our lipoic acid is actually a very expensive raw material, and I think there may be more marketing behind it than actual data, where the RS is the form. You'll generally just see it called alpha-lipoic acid. We call it alpha-lipoic acid in our line. It's in CMCOR and our dioxinol formula. But that's the more cost-effective form.
Do you sell something that has both?
berberine out and oplofocus?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, CM-Core. CM-Core has both. And we have information sheets for you guys up here, too, if you wanted to grab some info on those, too. So we've learned about berberine, we've learned about oplofolic acid, and now we have dioxinol. Dioxinol is a product, contains several ingredients. I'll quickly address each of them. But biotin, chromium, alpha-lipoic acid, once again, pillar nutrient, one of the things you should definitely take away from this talk. Cinnamon bark. You guys know that cinnamon is actually useful for blood sugar, blood insulin levels? Use it as a spice in your cooking. They actually make in a raw material that could be used for supplements something called sinulin, which is a patented cinnamon bark extract that's equivalent to very high amounts of cinnamon in a very small dose. So what they do is they remove the type A polymers, these things that are actually what give cinnamon its beneficial effects, and they concentrate it, and that's called sinulin. And then an ingredient that's actually really useful, that it almost acts as insulin-like properties, called vanadyl sulfate. So dioxinol, what we're trying to do, what we're aiming to do, is we're going to look at the cell, and there's thousands upon thousands of signals constantly going off in the cell. There's signaling pathways. The cell is doing all types of things always. There's a breakdown in these signaling pathways as it relates to glucose metabolism, insulin sensitivity, and basically looking at that analogy I made before of the sump pump, we have the flooded basement, equivalent of the cells in the body with blood sugar. Do a really good job in with many things you can do with lifestyle modification, metformin, that can remove the water. So things are no longer there. You've taken care of the blood sugar, the high blood sugar problem, but the damage to the signaling pathways are still there. So what we're trying to do with dioxinol is fix the signaling pathways. So we have a basement that's all beat up, moldy walls, the subfloor has been messed up, it just needs to be repaired. So what we're trying to do, and use this analogy for the cell, is rebuild and restore it to optimal function. So that's what's taking place with dioxinol. So how blood sugar is maintained, it's complicated, and excuse me if I get too complicated, but basically you want to look in two directions. This is the cell membrane, this is the insulin receptor. In the presence of glucose, you basically have the pancreas activated to secrete insulin. Insulin, again, is the key to the door. So insulin will dock here at the insulin receptor. And actually, through a cascade of events that takes place in the cell, these are all signal pathways that more or less activate GLUT4. So I mentioned GLUT4 before, but GLUT4 lies dormant within the cell. And then once it's activated by the insulin receptor, rises to the surface of the cell. You'll see on the other side where that's the door. It's now been opened. Now glucose can enter the cell. Glucose enters the cell all the way to the right there, and basically enters the metabolism pathways where it's converted to energy. So when looking at our progression in the metabolic continuum, whether it's high blood sugar levels that have been mismanaged over time, or high insulin levels now that are present because of that, addressing these signaling pathways in the cell is necessary. So dioxinol looks at multiple pathways as opposed to just AMPK. It looks at the insulin receptor, it looks at GLUT4. It actually does look at, this is another drug mechanism right here, PI3K. So it actually addresses that as well. But here's just some quick research. Sorry.
Yeah, what's the vanadium doing? Is that missing in the soil or something? Why is vanadium in that?
Vanadium here?
Vanadium?
Yeah, vanadium.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's actually a nutrient that...
Is missing in the soil?
Oh, in the soils? You know, I'm not too familiar with that.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a nutrient that could be considered a... it's more so of like a mineral, not a nutrient, but...
It's a mineral, yeah.
Yeah. And, given the way the soil condition probably in this day and age, where all fertilizers are basically used to make up for that, it wouldn't surprise me that it's been stripped out at some point. But vanadyl sulfate activates the activation of that GLUT4 transport. So it itself, independent of the presence of insulin, will actually activate GLUT4 and support GLUT4 activation. So we're opening that door. Chromium. Chromium and cinnamon together. Basically, this is just some research that looked at type 2 diabetic patients. Short time, just over 3 months. They looked at cinnamon extracts, equivalent to what we're doing with sinulin, and found that they were able to improve fasting blood glucose levels, HbA1c. More with chromium. Chromium is an essential mineral. It's actually essential in looking at the cell's ability to be sensitive to the presence of insulin. So chromium is one of those pillar nutrients, once again, when looking at insulin sensitivity. But more research here. 43 subjects, 600 micrograms of chromium, just for 4 weeks. And you were able to see that it modulates the insulin activation. So the insulin docking at the insulin receptor, and it's able to receive that. Any questions? So again, we're looking at that flooded basement, which has become the moldy basement, but you know, we've dealt with the blood sugar at that point, but we're just trying to rebuild our metabolic reserve of these nutrients that are key for those signals that need to be sent within the cell. And overall, rebuild the cell, rebuild the basement. I wish my basement looked like that. I bet you Donald Trump's does. You know? But So the question that we commonly get, can you take both? Yes. So if you have a more severe cardiometabolic risk, if you're a type 2 diabetic, if you have 5 or more metabolic risk factors, so remember the 5 criteria of metabolic syndrome, if you have all 5 of those, you may want to consider taking both of them combined with some of the lifestyle modification therapies. And then, of course, you know, you could readdress the supplements and the lifestyle modification medications with your healthcare practitioner over time. Other than that, does anyone have any questions for me? Anything I can answer?
Is there, as far as like somebody's a diabetic already, mm-hmm. the product diethoxazole would be more probably appropriate for them rather than the first couple of years?
Yeah, if you're kind of far along the line in the metabolic continuum, so you're further along into the disease diagnosis, then the diaxanol would probably be a better choice. The CM-Core, you could always make an argument to use CM-Core or use them in combination, but for more aggressive support, diaxanol is usually the one you'll reach for.
And L-lipoic could be used by anyone wanting to decrease their metabolic syndrome.
Yeah, alpha-lipoic acid is again, that pillar nutrient that almost anyone should take. It helps with the glucose uptake. It helps with the oxidation. And it's been used traditionally for diabetic neuropathy pain. So anyone with diabetic neuropathies, or if you know, alpha-lipoic acid is a treatment for that. Anything else?
What if your blood sugar is 90? Do you have to do anything?
Well, it seems to be managed, but, you know, at that point, you might want to look at other risk factors. What other risk factors are present? Is it kind of going back to that slide that looks at metabolic syndrome? Is blood the HDL cholesterol or my triglycerides high? If your blood sugar is at 90 and you don't possess any of these other risk factors, probably in pretty good shape, and you just want to make sure that you can maintain that. So, you know, we're all at some point in this metabolic continuum. Every single one of us in this room are somewhere along that continuum. Where are we on that continuum is the question. And someone with a blood sugar 90 and 0 risk factors are probably on the left side of that line, if you remember.
If you're diabetic and you're on metformin, can you gradually decrease it and get on berberine and substitute? You don't want to take a drug, you want to take something more natural?
Yeah, if you're able to get things under control and they can gradually reduce your metformin dose, then yeah, you could replace it with the proper lifestyle modifications and certain ingredients, of course, like the CM-Core or diaxanol ingredients. That's definitely something you do to answer your question directly. The problem is most people want to increase your dose of metformin, not decrease your dose of metformin. So.
A lot of doctors now are finding if you're doing things and you're not saying I'm going to take this and I'm never taking the drug again. That is dangerous. But what we found is a lot of people, we've added in diaxanol if they've been on glyburide and metformin. And then all of a sudden, over a month or two, you start seeing the A1C going down when they have it checked, and you see their blood sugar on tests are going down, and then they go to the doctor. If the blood sugar is getting not too low, but they're doing better, most doctors are very happy to say, gee, that's great. Let's not stop it. Let's decrease the dose a little and follow it for another 3 months. And we have a lot of people who are on medicine that are on much lower doses. We also have a lot of people who don't realize they have a problem, but every time they eat, even if it's a good meal, they fall asleep at work. So either they're bored with their job, which is one issue, but if most of the time you eat a relatively healthy diet and you need to take a nap, that's a blood sugar issue.
Yeah.
And doing something CM-Core, the diaxanol has been very helpful in changing that. Also, Brian, as you mentioned, the fiber product.
Yeah.
You know, the part of why an apple, all the sugar in the apple doesn't spike it is there's a lot of complex fibers in there that have to be broken down that release it. So fiber is very good. One, you started with digestion and elimination, but also it helps slow the release and the breakdown of a lot of the foods. And the soluble and insoluble, it helps feed the good bacteria, which is very good. We need to keep them happy, too.
So if you fall asleep at 4 o'clock...
Well, it could be a lot of things. It could be, it's been a long day.
You might just be bored.
You could be bored. But also, going back to eating, if you eat breakfast, lunch, supper, and you don't have a healthy snack in between, assuming you're eating well,
okay,
your blood sugar drops.
That's
and a lot of people are finding that they want to lose weight. So you have lunch at 12, and I'm going to be home for dinner at 7, so I'm not going to eat until I get home. And what happens is blood sugar gets too low. Then you go home, you have this delicious meal, your belly's out to here, and you're grazing all night long because blood sugar went too low. And the brain's saying, feed me, and you wind up grabbing a handful of cereal or crackers or a piece of candy, even though you ate a good meal. So by eating regularly, you wind up putting more calories in, better calories, metabolic rate goes up, blood sugar stays stable, and you burn off the belly fat.
What's some of the snacks that you can have?
Well, really, it's the good fats, the good proteins, the complex carbs. So it can be, if you have a good multi-grain something with nuts, nut butter, good healthy cheese, and everything, really basically everything nature gave us in moderation. If man starts changing it, like eggs, we labeled eggs bad because it has cholesterol. Cholesterol isn't bad. It's if it's too high with other markers or the bad fats, we should be eating butter, not margarine. Margarine should be outlawed.
Yeah.
It's all hydrogenated fat. But it's great, there's no cholesterol in it, and it's killing us.
Mm-hmm.
Have a little butter. If you eat a pound of butter a week, you have a problem. Come talk to us. But with some butter, it's fine. If you're eating peanut butter or nut butter, eat the real ground-up nuts. Don't get it with hydrogenated fats added to it. You took a great thing and ruined it.
Is so, almond butter better than peanut butter?
Depends upon what you like. If you're not allergic to peanuts and don't react to peanuts.
I thought there was some mold in peanuts.
Well, there is, but some people don't have problems. But then, varieties of spice of life. Alternate the butters. Alternate the foods.
Are doctors okay with this lately? I mean,
yeah.
Regular MDs, are they okay with
we're finding a lot of them are, and part of the reason is that a lot of people, when they start raising the dose of metformin,
mm-hmm.
they start getting the GI symptoms.
Yeah.
Then you're adding a drug to slow down the bowel,
yep.
and
yeah.
that changes everything. But the main thing I'll say, don't ever, when I hear people say, I'm never going back to my doctor, or I'm never going to take a drug
mm-hmm.
again, that's dangerous. Or I'm now taking this so I can stop my metformin. You're out of your mind. What you want to do is, what if you don't need as much metformin because your lifestyle, just exercising, your blood sugar will drop. So you don't need 1,000 milligrams or 1,500 milligrams. You might only need 1,000 or 500. That's a good thing. That's not a bad thing. So by helping the body, do the work properly, you don't need one. I'd like your analogy with the basement. One I use is you bought a triple decker and it needs a lot of work. So the drugs are the artificial support. The foundation's a little shaky. You put jacks in to hold the house up so your investment doesn't fall down. We use drugs as jacks. And if all of a sudden the house is shifting, we have more jacks to put in. How about you use the jacks to hold the house up, fix the foundation, then slowly take the pressure off the jacks and check, see if I'm level. If your blood sugar's good, when you drop down your dose, great. Let's see if we can even get it a little further. You don't just knock all the jacks out. That help?
That's awesome.
Okay, we'll be around. We can all go upstairs. It's a little more spacious.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
We'll be glad to answer your questions. And remember, everything 20% off if you want to try it. We'll be around. Feel free to call us if you have questions. We'll be glad to work with you.
I definitely have questions.
Okay.
I think I know how.